are on the clock.
Yay! Okay. So, good morning.
Good morning.
Everybody else is feeling this Friday excitement. It's almost Saturday. So, yesterday you left off World War II. We were talking about Total War. Who remembers what Total War is?
Towards
the war effort. So, minorities were no exception. Despite the fact that minorities were living as second-class citizens in the U.S. and were facing segregation and discrimination and racism, they participated fully in the war effort and played an important role in both fighting and winning World War II. So here's some images. So first we're going to start off and talk about the racial tension became so bad that President Roosevelt had to issue an executive order in 1941 telling employers to, quote, provide for the full and equitable participation of all workers in defense industries without discrimination because of race, creed, color, or national origin. Unfortunately, there were 47 race riots during World War II. And this led to what is known as the double V. So the V was used as a symbol for victory over Nazi Germany, over fascism. But for African Americans, they came up with the double V symbol, which symbolized victory both at home and abroad, which I actually have. Next, we're going to talk about Mexican Americans. Mexican Americans benefited from higher paying jobs in the defense industry in both California and Texas. However, this wasn't their only exceptionally important contribution. I don't know if any of you have heard about kind of World War II in England, but there's a lot of PBS shows on World War II. And as a history nerd, I like to watch them. And when I was reading about the Braceros, I thought it was very interesting, the connection. In England, when men left to go fight in World War II, somebody had to take care of the farms. And so they created this whole, what was called the Women's Land Army. But I never kind of thought through, well, what did we do, right? Because a lot of men were gone. They left. They had to go fight the war. So who fed us? Well, Mexican Americans fed us. They migrated from Mexico and moved all over the U.S. to help fill those positions in the farms. And I actually watched like a little documentary clip, which was made a really good point. When people talk about World War II and the home front effort, very rarely, like I've never heard until I started doing this project, about the braceros. But they did play a really vital role to making sure that there was enough food both here and that also food made it abroad. Unfortunately, again, whites resented the migration. This migration, which led to race riots in Los Angeles. So I think one of the best known groups of minorities during World War II is women, right? We've all seen Rosie the Riveter, We Can Do This, because over 200,000 women served in military and non-combat roles, such as nurses, ambulance drivers, radio operators, electricians, and pilots. They took higher paying jobs in the defense industry than had been previously held by men. In addition to working in the defense industry, women just worked in factories. They were there was a lot of propaganda to target women, like we saw yesterday, right? The fact. Well, not only was it like, save your goods at home, but it was also like, leave your home, go work in the factory, which created resentment among men because there was concern of like, well, what's going to happen when our boys come home? And it was like, you have to, like towards the end of the war began this kind of like campaign of like, leave your job, go back to the kitchen. And that leads into like the 50s and this like re-idealization of like the housewife. So women kind of had, they faced their own discrimination and a lot of anger, I think, towards women that they were in the workforce, like be in the workforce, help us win the war, but then leave the workforce because those jobs are for our men. So now we're going to switch to minority contributions at the war front. So African Americans, Japanese Americans, and Native Americans all served in segregated units. And most of these minority units were highly achieving and also suffered high casualty rates. Does everybody know what casualty, the word casualty means?
Injury or death.
Injury or death, yes. So most minority units suffered high casualty rates, and they also won numerous citations and individual medals for bravery. So African Americans, more than 1 million African Americans served in segregated units, primarily in non-combat units. Does anybody want to guess why they were only allowed to serve in non-combat units?
Do you want African Americans like at the front of the war fighting for that they wanted white people?
No, because they didn't trust them. Yeah, nothing that like. And so it's pretty crazy. Every single group of minorities had to fight for the right to fight and die. And so African Americans actually protested to be able to go and fight for their country and a country that wasn't treating them fairly, which I think is like very noble. And actually, Tuskegee Airmen were one of the best known. I think if you think of World War II and you think of a unit, like I don't know any unit except for the Tuskegee Airmen because they were so good at what they did. And they were known as one of the best units in the war. They played major roles in many dangerous missions in Europe. And still, I don't know if anybody's ever seen somebody's license plate, but people will have like Tuskegee Airmen license plates, which is, so they're like definitely lived on to infamy. Next we have Japanese Americans who also had a really hard time of it. So who remembers internment, right? Did we discuss internment yet?
Yes.
Who can, what is Japanese internment? Yes.
It's basically a concentration camp.
Yeah, for Japanese. So it was bred from, right, like distrust, right? So if you're Japanese, you're definitely not American. You're like, you're with the enemy, you're not with us. And so we had over 30,000 Japanese Americans serving in the military during the war in the Nisei unit, which was a unit of second generation Americans, and they volunteered to go fight for America while their families were sitting in concentration camps. So if you've, has anybody seen The Karate Kid? Mr. I think his name is Miyagi, yes. So he is actually, his character is based loosely on a collection of soldiers from the Nisei Regiment, and the idea of like, you kind of see that he fought in this war while his wife and his child were like in a concentration camp, basically, which was normal for this regiment. And they fought exceptionally hard to prove, because they fought with something to prove. And they had this slogan, which was "Go for broke," which then became super popular in like films and movies. And they served as spies and interpreters in the Pacific, and they served with distinction in combat and became one of the most decorated units in American history. And Harry Truman actually, I've found this quote that I thought was very interesting. He said, "You fought not only the enemy, but you fought prejudice, and you won and kept up that fight. And we will continue to win to make this great republic stand for the ways the Constitution says it stands for." So there was, it took almost 40 years for Americans to acknowledge the wrongdoing of the internment camps, but President Harry Truman did acknowledge their excellent service and somewhat the irony of their service. Native Americans, approximately 25,000 Native Americans served with distinction in combat, worked in the defense industry, and provided unique and valuable service. Has anybody heard of the Navajo Code Talkers? Shaking your head? No? No? Okay, so the Navajo Code Talkers. So back in the day, right, code was a really big deal because this is how you were trying to get information from one person to the next without the information being intercepted. But it's super hard over radio frequency to make sure that nobody's going to listen to you, right? Because somebody can just, if they find your station, they can listen to what you're saying. So the Navajo code talkers were super vital because nobody knew the Navajo language except for them. So the Japanese couldn't interpret or break their code, which I thought is super cool. Mexican Americans. So many Mexican Americans worked in the defense industries, as we saw in the home front slide, and about 300,000 served with distinction in the military. However, Mexican Americans were the only group of minorities that were not segregated. They were allowed to serve with everybody. So, any questions? Okay, so I have enough, I think I do. So in pairs, I have enough for everybody to have. So I went online and found different sources that deal with different minority experiences during World War II. And so I have three questions for you to read. Just some of them are articles, some of them are images. So with your partner, I want you to look at the source and discuss and consider, how does the source challenge or add to your idea of minority experiences during World War II? And the second question is, what does your source tell you about this particular minority group's experience and role during World War II? The difference being, like, for me, like, there's a lot of information that I found that's really challenged my ideas of, you know, what World War II was or what different people's participation was in World War II. So that's part of the first question. And the second, just like added information. And then the third, consider what you've learned about minority contribution and experiences during World War II. How did these experiences of discrimination and justice lead to major political events of the 1960s? And then the fourth is just, if you have some patience with me and just write some feedback about my lecture and the activity, but like afterwards. And then after we do this, we can we'll go around the room and share what your source is and what you kind of what your thoughts are. I think this is one. If it's two, can you pass one back?
So, like, how do you think that, you know, what do you think is this dynamic of, like, in the picture she's wearing heels and everything, it looks pretty, but really she works at a heavy factory where she has Yeah, think on that. I'll be right back.
But what did you say?
I'm curious. I'm not gonna.
white squares with their notes.
Yeah.
You always do squares. You're like
squares.
No,
yeah.
During World War II.
Okay, so we had this.
country, but know your place. Because it's not going to be in the factory long term. It's not going to be having a job or rights. Well, their recognition, I think, was definitely like put down to make room for more. Can you, do you know, did you make a connection to the civil rights and to the to what's coming? So women's liberation. Right. Thank you so much. That's wonderful.
We had and he says, women firefighters aim a hose at the fire after the attack on Pearl Harbor. So for a second question, we said, women had to take over men's jobs and roles. They helped during Pearl Harbor because the men were in trouble. It was many races of women in World War II to shake up the status because they wanted to separate everybody. But because of this, it brought everyone closer together. And for the third question, we said, in World War I, women were overlooked, and in World War II, they stepped it up, and now they're, like, somewhat equal men.
They're fighting for their equality. Yeah, so on one hand, it's like we want to continue segregating and discriminating, but on the other hand, we have to allow people to do certain things, certain jobs, because we just don't have the ability to fill them. And then it's like, this idea like, well, I could have a job and I could have equality, so maybe I should, you know, like I can have this. Next group.
All right, we got this little bad joke. Her name is Naomi Parker, more famously known as Rosie the Riveter. You know, the joke is like this.
Yeah, Rosie the Riveter.
So she's working in heels at the Alameda Naval Air Station during World War II.
And, question number one is, how does this source challenge or add to your idea of minorities' experiences during World War II? This image made women look less scary to others and made them look less threatening.
Yeah, would you guys imagine Rosie the Riveter wearing heels?
No.
No. Right? So when I saw this picture, I was like, that's crazy. But it's really, it makes total sense, right? Because, like, if you're going to take a picture of Rosie the Riveter, you don't want her to look only strong. You want her to look very nice and pretty, and like she can go home after she, you know, puts together your tank. Do you have some more? Do you have anything else to share? You want to add?
Question two says, how does your source tell you about this minority experience and role and roles during World War II? I wrote, they were meant to work in factories.
Yes, they were meant to work in factories, but they were meant to remember that this wasn't their permanent place. Okay, do you have, okay, next group.
Okay, so we got a little bar graph statistic thingy. And so basically it was, the question on here is, when factories deciding which workers to keep on for peacetime jobs, what should be done about women workers? Basically, everybody said that they should fire all the women workers because the men were coming back and they needed their jobs.
So basically what we thought about that is that women were just seen as like placeholders for men until they returned from the war and took back their jobs. And women really had to like fight for the right to keep working, which sort of like went into the 60s and sort of like inspired
Great job, wonderful. Okay, boys in the back.
Okay, so our source was a pie chart, and it was describing what it was a survey actually of what African Americans felt they had to try hardest to do in America, and about a quarter of them said that it was to make things better for themselves. 30% said it was to try hardest to win the war, and then 37% said it was to do both at the same time. This source adds to my idea that minorities, because it shows that African Americans were still oppressed even when they were just fighting for our country. The source tells us that war wasn't just between world powers, it was also within our United States. There was racial tension almost everywhere. It led to a further expansion of the civil rights movement because it showed the true discrimination in America, not only in places like the South, but even places like the North. And lastly, it was a good source.
It was interesting. Here is the double B, right?
Yeah.
Both Victory at Home and Abroad. Nice script.
Okay. So, our source was a quote from a African American veteran who was in the Air Force, and you'll hear it. So, it said, I think that some of the things about World War II, when we got overseas in Italy, black and white, we were all brothers. We all were a team, so we relied on one another. Those guys forgot about their racist attitudes. When the war ended and we came back to the States, the most amazing thing, I remember this for the rest of my life. We were coming down the gangplank, getting off the boat. Now there were more blacks in the boat coming back because they brought our country together, and they had a sign on the bottom of the gangplank, whites to one side, colored to the other. And I said to myself, this is some country. I'm fighting for democracy, and this is the first time that I even thought about fighting for recognition as a first-class citizen in my own country. I was fighting for the democracy, and I had to fight for the right to fight. I thought America was a sick country. So our first question, how does the source challenge or add to your idea of minorities' experiences during World War II? We said that it didn't really challenge or add to our experiences just because we kind of already knew how America treated minorities and how they kind of just sold a good story and used people for whatever they needed, and then after still went back to kind of mistreating them in a way. And then what does the source tell you about the minority group's experience? So we said that the experience initially was like good, like they were just happy to be able to fight for the country and in some type of way feel some type of like togetherness or united with the country. So, but then after we said that his spirit was kind of broken afterwards when he got home because he was met with reality and how people really felt towards him as being an African American. And then how did those type of experiences lead to movements in the 1960s, like the civil rights movement? And we just said like how African Americans were like tired of the mistreatment, and they felt since the World War II like they had like died for the country and still didn't take them in, that they were gonna do something about it.
Yeah, World War II gave a taste of like fighting and being equal in the battlefield, and being able to die the same way as the person next to you was like, I am equal. Why am I not being treated as such? And it helped propel these feelings into actions and more like anger.
Okay. For our source, we have a picture or an image. It says, we want white tenants in our white community. It takes place in Detroit. It was a race riot at a federal housing project with like white neighbors. They wanted to prevent black or African Americans from moving in. So they said, the quote, we want white tenants in our white community. For number two, what the source tells us about the group's experience. It told us about how African Americans were mistreated and discriminated to a point of which they can't even peacefully obtain a housing project, even in places like Detroit, not even just the South, even though they were all fighting for the same thing in World War II. For number three, considering what we've learned and all that stuff, for number three we put the discrimination would eventually lead to African Americans wanting to earn equality because they were tired of being mistreated and segregated, not just in the South, but in the North as well, which would eventually lead to protests, such as the Civil Rights Movement.
That's great. Yeah, I looked at, when I saw this image, I showed it to my husband. He was like, oh, that must have been in Tennessee. And I was like, no, Detroit. Like, how crazy is that? Like, this was an issue everywhere, not just in the South. And so openly, I think it was, crazy.
So we got the executive order from President
there's American, just an actress as much as many other Americans were. And now they had someone to advocate for them so that they could have their rights like spoken about. And the question number two, we said the minority groups at the beginning were not given the opportunity to fight. They had to beg and plead to get there. And for three, we said these experiences of fighting began to fuel minority groups and the practice of starting to truly fight for their rights to represent.
Thank you, great job. I think we're running out of time, so I'll just collect, sorry, those of you who did not get to share. And thank you for participating. If you haven't gotten a chance to fill out the form question about feedback, I'll appreciate it. Thank you so much for being a great class.
Thank you.
This is wonderful.
All right, darlings, on Monday you have your last two guided readings. We have quiz, so two questions on each of them. I will attempt to send out something on Sunday, but we know that I don't always do that. So I get wrapped up in life and forget that you have a quiz. Sorry. That would be awesome. Okay, love you. Have a good weekend. Stay dry.
Oh, yeah. I guess